chance for you to bring it to... Impossible for God? No, I'm considering he's the one who has given me his word. He's the one who's given me his promises. He's the one that has to bring it to pass. Well, Father, this morning, we thank you so much for your goodness. We thank you so much for your presence that's in this place. Now, Lord, as we spend time in your word, Lord, I ask that you will give me the ability to deliver this word that you have for this place. Lord, I say that we have ears to hear, or you wouldn't have placed this on my heart. And Lord, that we will take it upon ourselves to do our part after we hear it. That we can rise up to that place you've called us to be. Lord, for there's new levels that we haven't seen. But as we take heart, as we do our part, as we act on what we hear, we'll see it's because you love us and you're drawing us so near. And those things that have seemed clouded and obstacles that have been in the way, they'll begin to fall by our side as we rise up higher in a new way. And as we go forth in the name of the Lord, as our hearts are purged from all sorts, we will see, Father God, the thing our hearts have longed for. We will see the things our hearts have cried out for. That we will see your glory in great manifestation in this place. That it will come in mighty manifestation and we'll run our race and we'll complete it, Lord. We'll complete it to the end. We thank you for it, Lord. This morning, if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to Hebrews, the sixth chapter, Hebrews 6. I feel like this is a word, if I had my druthers, I would have held it for next Sunday because a lot of people are out today with the holiday weekend. But who knows, maybe we'll stay on it and stay on this until... Hebrews 6, have you found Hebrews 6? The 12th verse says this, that you be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promise. You know, very often when we see that word slothful, we have this idea that it's talking about being lazy. But you know, in the Greek, if you were to go and Greek this out, and I by no means am a Greek scholar, but I thank God for Strong's Concordance and Greek scholars who are. And if you go back and you look at this word does not mean lazy. Now notice he said that we need to follow those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. And when you look at this word slothful, it means slow. It means boring. Think of that. Don't be boring. Don't be slow. It means monotonous. It means unexcited. It's something that has lost its speed and something that has lost its momentum. And I just feel that each and every one of you needs to hear today that with your walk with the Lord, you can lose your speed. You can lose your momentum. You can become slow. You can become unexcited. It can become boring. It can become monotonous. The paraphrase to Hebrews 6:12, I like this, is quit being slothful. Quit acting like someone who has lost his enthusiasm and excitement and now is sunk into a state of being slow, boring, and monotonous, sluggish, dull, and uninterested. Now, when we go a few more chapters up in Hebrews 11, it says this, but without faith it is impossible to please him. Now, remember, we're supposed to be imitators of those who through faith and patience inherited the promise. That tells me that those who we can look at and imitate were those who did not become boring, monotonous, slow, dull. Yeah. unexcited? You look at Paul. I mean, here is a guy, if anybody had a reason to quit, if anybody had a reason to slow down, it would have been him. But yet, he never slowed down. When you think of what he went through, when you think that the beatings that he went through, the 40 lashes minus one, five different times. When you talk about this, most of his ministry was done by foot. He had to walk. You didn't do it. You know, you didn't make an airline reservation. There was times he got on a ship to get where he was going, but most of the time he was walking. And here he had been beaten three times with rods. That's where they would take your foot and they would beat your foot bloody with rods. Many people would never recover from it or be able to walk again, but he must have known something about the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead, that it dwelled in him and it would quicken and make alive his mortal flesh body. He must have known something about it. I mean, this is the guy that was stoned with rocks and they thought he was dead. They thought he'd given up the ghost. And when they stoned people, they wanted to make sure that your skull was crushed. But still, there must have been the resurrection of the power of the Lord, that he had a relationship with the Holy Spirit and it raised him up. He might have been dead. We don't know. But he never quit. He never lost his zeal. He never got unexcited. When one door was closed and it looked like he couldn't go any further, and I'm talking about our walk with Jesus today, but I'm talking about your walk in life today also. Just because one door closed doesn't mean it's over. Just because one door's closed doesn't mean that God isn't still for your vision and still has a plan. You just might need to find out what the other workaround is going to be to get to it. He said, but without faith, it's impossible to believe him. Who, for him that comes to God must believe that he is. How many people believe that he is? But here's this other part we've got to see, and that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Say, he's a rewarder. Once, what does he reward us with? He rewards us. One of the things that he rewards us with when we seek him is more faith. Isn't that right? And so here he is. He rewards us if we diligently seek him. But this is the thing. Are we diligently seeking him? Are you not seeing the rewards that you are looking for? Are there some rewards that you think should have already came into manifestation? Is there some answers that you think should have already showed up on the horizon? Is there some things that should have already been made present in your life? Could it be that this area is lacking, that there's a lack of diligence in our seeking the Lord? It's either true or it's not. He either rewards us when we diligently seek him or he doesn't. I happen to believe that he does. Here's the Amplified version. But without faith, it is impossible to please and be satisfactory to him. For whoever would come near to God must necessarily believe that God exists and that he is a rewarder of those who earnestly and diligently seek him out. Seek him out. You know the scripture, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto us. Hebrews 10:35. You see, I just sense this. You know, I just sense this in the body of Christ. Right now, there's a tendency to slack. Right now, there's a tendency to draw back. Right now, there's a tendency to lose our zeal. Right now, there's a tendency to fall asleep, and we need to awake. If there's ever a time we need to be awake, we need to be awake right now. He said this in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, the 35th verse. So do not throw away this confident trust in the Lord. Remember the great reward it brings you. Patient endurance is what you need now, so that you will continue to do God's will. Then you will receive all that he has promised. For in just a little while, the coming one will come and not delay. Do you know he's coming back soon? In just a little while, he's coming back. And my righteous ones will live by faith. But I will take no pleasure in anyone who turns away. But we are not like those who turn away from God. Say, I'm not like those that turn away from God to my own destruction. We are the faithful ones whose souls will be saved. So that tells me that there's also something in here that there can be a tendency to draw back. And listen, God says, I take no pleasure in those that draw back. Do you want to please God? It takes faith to please God. But if we aren't diligently seeking Him, then really He takes no pleasure in us. Is it because He's withholding things from us because of a lack of it? Well, you know, it could be. I said it could be. It could be that we're not seeking His face the way that we need to seek His face. It could be that He's already made the way. You know, so often we think that it's just something automatic that if we just believe God, but there's always a foot side to faith. There's always something you have to put your feet to. He can give you just one little key to whatever your situation is as you're diligently seeking Him. And one little key that when you act on it, when you take that key, it unlocks the door. It unlocks the lock and it causes the thing that you've been believing for to be made manifest, something that God has desired to get you to get to you the whole time. Right. Let's go here a little bit further. Revelations 2, 1 through 7. Unto the angel of the church at Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walk in the midst of the golden candlesticks. I know thy works and thy labor, in thy patience, and how then thou cannot bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. You know, it sounds like they're doing all the right things, doesn't it? Sounds like they haven't given up. They haven't fainted. They haven't thrown in the towel. They don't put up with false apostles. I mean, sounds like they're doing some of the things, but then he said, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee because thou hast left thy first love. You know, you can be doing a lot of the right things and have left your first love. Absolutely. Who's supposed to be your first love? Well, this is Jesus speaking. This is Jesus speaking to the church. And what he's really saying is, you have left me. You have left me. I am no longer your first love. I am no longer your all in all. I am no longer the first thing, the most important thing, the most precious thing that is in your life. You've left your first love. Now notice what he tells us to do. He says, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen and repent. You know, that's not a very popular word in the church today. But it's a word found in the Bible. It means repent. Repent means to change our mind. Repent means to change our direction, to change the way that we're going. Repent means, yeah, we're supposed to be sorry about the way that we found ourselves and where we're at. But it's an action. I said it's an action. Repent always involves an action. Repent isn't just, I'm sorry. Repent is, I'm no longer going to go this way. Repent is, I'm sorry, I've left my first love. I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm going back to my first love. And then look what he says to do. And do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and remove thy candlestick out of this place, except thou repent. How many remember the first works? How do you remember when you first got saved? I mean, when you really got saved. I mean, I'm talking about when you really got saved and you knew you were saved. I mean, there was no doubt about it. How many remember where you were? How many do you remember the things that you were hungry for? How many remember when you could hardly wait to get in the Word? How many remember when you had to hear the Word? I mean, all the time you were listening to the Word. You might have been driving down the road, and all the time you were listening to the Word. You were hungry for the Word. I remember when you were so excited to see God move. How many remember when you used to tell everybody about Jesus, and you were so excited about the change that was in your life? How many remember when you used to like to be in the house of God whenever the doors were open? Wouldn't miss a service. Come on. I mean, willing to go without sleep. I mean, not if some of you haven't experienced this, willing to stand in lines to get a seat because you didn't want to sit in overflow and watch it on a video projector. I'm talking, listen, this is the whole deal. Do we want revival or don't we? God comes to hungry hearts. God comes to people who want Him. God comes to people who put Him first and desire Him above anything else. I mean, I've been in meetings where you had to stand outside the door on a hot Florida day. And they didn't open the doors until an hour before service started. And I'm telling you, and then it was a mad dash for the auditorium, and it was a mad dash for the front. How many people remember when you used to like to sit up front so you didn't get distracted by all the nonsense in the back sometimes? Oh, I'm preaching really good now. Huh? I mean, Christians almost fighting each other for seats. Supposed to walk in love. Why? Because they were hungry. People would take time off. Paid. They'd take their vacation. They'd take their vacation time so that they could go, and because they were hungry for the things of God, and they wanted to see God move, and they were willing to go wherever it took. They'd will take their days to go do it on their own time and their own money. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of this place, except thou repent. He said, but this thou hast, thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saying unto the church. To him that overcomes will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. The Message version says it this way. I see what you've done, your hard work, your refusal to quit. I know you can't stomach evil and you weed out apostolic pretenders. I know your persistence, your courage in my cause, that you never wear out. Boy, that sounds like they're doing everything right, doesn't it? But you walked away from your first love. Why? What's going on with you anyway? Do you have any idea how far you've fallen? A Lucifer fall. Turn back. Recover your dear early love. No time to waste. For I am well on my way to removing your light from the golden circle. You do have this to your credit. You hate the Nicolaitan business. I hate it too. You know, that's so fitting for today. Because you know what the doctrine of the Nicolaitans was? The Nicolaitans were a sect. It was named after Nicholas, who at one time was an apostle. And he at one time he was a heathen, and he converted to Judaism. So he went from being a heathen to being religious. And then he heard about Christianity, and he heard the message preached, and he went ahead and he converted to Christianity. But before all that, when he was a heathen, he was involved in pagan worship. He was involved in what we call paganism. You know, there's a whole lot of that in the earth today. A lot of this stuff we are seeing with going on in our nation, it's rooted in pagan. We are quickly going back to a pagan society. And yet, what happened is, and then after he got saved, what his doctrine was is that it was still all right to do the things that the pagans were doing. And he tried to bring a mixture of the worldliness and the things that pagans do, and he was trying to bring a mixture and tell other people around him, influence them, that God was all right with it. Does that sound familiar today? And God commended him for hating that doctrine. I tell you what, I'm glad that I got God on my side for that one. Now let's look at Revelations, the third chapter. The 14th verse. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because you're lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and open the door. Say, be zealous, therefore. And open the door. I will come in to him and will sup with him, and him with me. To him that overcomes will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and sat down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the church. Now notice what he was saying here. I think it's interesting that he said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Think of that. A lot of people use this for people who aren't saved. They say, behold, I stand at the door and knock. He's talking to the church right there. He's saying, I'm at your door and I'm knocking. You have to be pretty lukewarm when you know to not know that the Lord is at the door, standing there wanting to knock. He wants to come in and sup with us. The Message version says it this way. I know you inside and out, and I find little to my liking. You're not cold, you're not hot. Far better to either cold or hot. You're stale, you're stagnant. You make me want to vomit. You brag I'm rich, I've got it made, I need nothing from anyone. Oblivious that in the fact you're a pitiful, blind beggar, threadbare, and homeless. Here's what I want you to do. Buy your gold from me, gold that's been thoroughly through the refiner's fire. Then you'll be rich. Buy your clothes for me, clothes designed in heaven. You've gone around half naked long enough. And buy medicine for your eyes for me so you can see, really see. The people I love I call to account, prod and correct and guide so that they'll live at their best. Up on your feet then, about face, run after God. Look at me, I stand at the door, I knock. If you hear me, call and open the door. I'll come right in and sit down to supper with you. Conquerors will sit alongside me at the head table, just as I, having conquered, took the place of honor at the side of my Father. That's my gift to the conquerors. Are your ears awake? Listen. Listen to the wind words, the Spirit blowing through the churches. And notice he said something about the waters being stagnant. You know, stagnant waters are stagnant for two different reasons. Stagnant waters are stagnant for a lack of what's coming into it. And stagnant waters can become stagnant for a lack of what is going out of it. It's an inflow and it's an outflow. It's kind of like a pond. You know, if you've ever, I remember as a child, my grandmother and grandfather, they made a pond, and I could show you probably 15 hours of footage while they did it. And they made this pond, and they were so excited about that pond. And I remember going down to that pond. We used to like to fish that pond. That thing was so overrun with bullheads and fish. I mean, you could cast in there, reel in, and catch a fish without even bait. You'd snag one. It was just loaded with fish. But you'd go down by that pond, and there'd be all this moss and all this algae and all this junk because there wasn't enough inflow and outflow. And I think that's how we get cold, because we're not getting enough inflow. We're not taking in enough of the Word. We're not taking in enough of the Spirit of God. We're not taking in enough of the things that God has for it. And we can become stagnant because we're not giving out. See, Jesus said this when he stood up on that great and notable day at the feast. He cried and he said, if any man thirsts, let him come after me and drink. He was talking about come, drink, come and get something. Drink of these waters, drink of these waters. And then he said this, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Spirit. So you had to drink something in so that something could begin to go out of you. And it hadn't changed. There's no shortcuts to this. There's no quick remedies. There's no There's no just one thing that you have to do for this. This is the way we're supposed to live our lives. We're supposed to live our lives excited about the things of the Lord. Going back to the pond, you know, the pond, let's just say it represents your life. And if I was to go down to that pond and I was to take a rock and I was to throw it into the pond, there would become a rippling of waves. And that rippling of waves, it would be in a circle and it would ripple out and it would go and it would touch every bank all around that pond. And that's how we're supposed to be with the Lord, that He comes and He throws His rock in our pond. Amen. And because of the rock that He's thrown in our pond, because of our born again experience, because of our relationship with God, that it has a rippling effect and it begins to touch every area in our life. That's why we can't get away from this. I said it earlier. We can't get away from this, seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then all these things shall be added unto you. If you will put God first, if you will seek Him first, then these other things that might be hindering you, these other things that might seem being held back, if you will put God first, it will have a rippling effect. It will begin to change other things around you. If you begin to put God first, if you begin to seek the kingdom first, I'm telling you, it will have a rippling effect on your finances. It will have a rippling effect in your prosperity. If you begin to put Him first, it will have a rippling effect in your physical body concerning your health. If you will begin to let that rock hit your pond, glory to God. It'll have a rippling effect in your marriage. It will have a rippling effect in your house and with your children. It will have a rippling effect on your job. It will begin to spread out and touch everything in our job. But what happens is we get all caught up in the day-to-day stuff, and this is where we find ourselves. Instead of turning our hearts back to God and putting Him first in our life and seeking Him first and going after Him with all our heart, soul, and our being. And as we do that, I'm telling you, He's watching over us to change the things that we can't change, to do the things that we can't change. Now notice He said, you need to desire for Me gold that's gone through the fire. You know, the thing about gold is gold has to be purified. You know, lots of times, you know, we don't talk about this much, but you know, you go through things in life, and very often it's to purify. Hard things, and I'm not saying God causes hard things, but when you go through hard things, I'm telling you, it can have a purifying effect. It can have a purifying effect on your heart. Brother Hagin used to say this. He would say when things aren't working. When things aren't working the way they should be working, when things aren't going the way that they should be going, he said, the first thing that I would do is I would check my heart. And I would make sure that there was nothing in my heart, that I didn't have any kind of ought, any kind of unforgiveness, that there was nothing in my heart, that my heart was pure, my heart was clear before God. I think that's good advice, because so often we're looking at all these other reasons. We're looking to bind the devil. We're looking to, you know, it's somebody else's fault. We're looking at all these things. But could it be that it's us? Could it be is that we're no longer seeking first the kingdom? Could it be that God is no longer first place in our life? Could it be? And so he said, you need to ask of me gold that's been purified in the fire. You know, gold is processed. They find gold and then they put it under extreme heat. They put it in the fire and all the impurities begin to come to the top. And then somebody that's there, he'll have a scoop and he'll take all the dross, all the impurities, and he'll scoop it off the top so that that gold is more pure than what it was when it started. You know, the fire of God will purify us. It's kind of like, where do pearls come from? Pearls are made through great distress. Isn't that right? And they end up being this beautiful thing. When we go through great distress, I'm telling you, if we will keep God foremost, keep God center, amen, we will come out, glory to God, as a beautiful pearl. Isaiah 64, I use this in prayer meeting last Wednesday. It says, oh, that thou wouldst rinse the heavens, and that thou would come down, that the mountains might flow down at thy presence. As when the melting fire burns, the fire causes the waters to boil, to make thy name known to thine adversaries, that the nations may tremble at thy presence. Have you felt like that? I mean, just with everything that's going on in our nation, oh, Lord, that you would just come down, Lord, that your fire would just hit the place, Lord. Your fire would just consume these things, Lord, that you would just come. We're just wanting it so bad. When thou did terrible things which we look not for, thou camest down, the mountains flowed down at thy presence. For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard, nor perceived by the ear, neither has the eye seen, O God, beside thee, what thou hast prepared for him that waits for him. Thou meetest him that rejoices and works his righteousness. Those that remember thee in thy ways. Notice he said, those that remember thee in thy ways. Behold, thou art wroth, for we have sinned. In those is continuance that we shall be saved, but we all as unclean thing, and all our righteousness are as filthy rags, and we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. And there is none that calleth upon thy name, now noticeth, and stirreth up himself to take a hold of thee. Who does it come down to? We're wanting God to come. I don't know, okay, I'm wanting God to come. I'm wanting him to show up. I'm wanting him to touch our city. I'm wanting him to touch our state. I'm wanting him to touch our nation. But he said, there's no one that stirs themselves up. There's no one that's stirring themselves up to take a hold of him. And it has to be us. We're the ones that have to do it. Do you remember Isaiah? Let me read this to you out of Isaiah, the 6th chapter. The first verse says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had 6 wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, and the whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, woe is me, for I am unclean, I'm undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. And he said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but perceive not. So what he realized is that he was undone. Say undone. You know, in the presence of God, we are all undone. He said, I am unclean. And the angel came and brought a hot coal off the altar and touched his lips and said, you're no longer undone. You're no longer unclean. And then he said, who's going to go? And he said, here am I, Lord, I'll go. Who's going to go? Who has to go? Who's the only ones that can go? You and me, those who have been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb, we're the only ones, those that have been purified through the fire of the Holy Ghost. You remember what Jesus said? When what John said concerning Jesus? He said, there's one that's coming after me, whose shoes I'm not even worthy to untie. And when he comes, he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. You know, it takes the fire of God. We've got to have the fire of God. I'm convinced more than ever, we've got to have the fire of God. It's going to take the fire of God to reach a lost and a dying world. It's going to take the fire of God to get us up to that next level, that next place. I mean, have you ever thought of a space shuttle? A space shuttle, it's here on Earth, and there's this law at work that is holding its back. It's the law of gravity. And so that space shuttle, it has to have enough fire underneath it that it takes it out of this law of gravity, that it takes it out of that atmosphere, and that fire gets it up out of this atmosphere where the law of gravity is at work. And when it gets past that, they no longer have to have that big thrust of fire that they had to have before to get it along. And I'm convinced we need to have a supernatural burst of space shuttle size Holy Ghost fire to get the church to the next place, to get the church to the next level, to the next realm that he has for us. And it's going to take his fire to do it. And then I have to say this. It's going to cost us something. See, people want a move of God. But I don't know if we really realize what it costs. Could you imagine if something like what happened in Brownsville happened here? Could you imagine going to church 6 days a week? Morning service, which ran beyond morning. Evening services that ran sometimes 12, 1, 2 o'clock in the morning for 5 years. 5 years. I mean, you talk about having to seek first the kingdom. You talk about having to put God first. You talk about how many other things in your life would get turned upside down. How many things in your life that, and I'm talking to me too, that maybe we feel is so important at this moment that maybe would just have to pale. Maybe we just have to lay it aside and make a decision. Maybe that's not so important. Maybe what's more important is a mighty move of God on the earth today. Maybe what's more important is balances that are filled with souls right now that are in the valley of decision that Jesus, listen, he's coming back soon. I mean, the hour, it's more important now than ever, but do we realize what it's really going to cost? Do we realize what it's really going to take? And listen, it's not about... It's not about having it inside a building. It's about having it inside of us. So that we can take it outside from the building. See, a lot of people don't realize that what was taking place. You got to realize, is it worth the cost? Is it worth laying my flesh on the altar? Is it worth putting some things aside? Is it worth it? You have to make that determination. But when you see the results of what is happening, the results that were taking place, the things that were breaking out all around that area, the people who came into that move of God and carried it with them to the far-flung places of the earth. I mean, when you look at the other things that took place, you have to say, are souls worth it? Are people coming back to Jesus worth it? Is it worth the cost? I mean, it began to break out in the schools. Before you knew it, kids who had been going to it, they would jump up in the cafeteria and they'd start preaching the word. And the Spirit of God would start falling, and one of the cafeteria workers would tell them to sit down, and another student would jump up and pick up right where the sermon was left off, and he'd begin to preach. They'd go into be sent to the principal's office, and the power of God was so strong on them that they would just sit there and shake under the power of God. And the principal and the teachers thought, there's something wrong with this kid. What is going on? But then the power of God would get off of them, and it would begin to touch the principals. And before you knew it, the administrators and the teachers and the workers are showing up at the revival, and they're getting saved and they're getting filled with the Holy Ghost. But my whole point is, somebody had to pay a price. Romans 12 1 says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the tender mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to the Lord, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You know, he said we're to present our bodies a living sacrifice on the altar. You know, an altar is not a pleasant place. When you have an altar, there is always going to be a victim. We talk about being a victim. At the altar, there was always going to be a victim. Do you remember what happened with Abraham and Isaac? And they went to the altar. There was going to be a victim that was going to be placed on the altar. Thank God he provided a sacrifice, and there was a ram that was caught in a thicket, and he used that. But the altar was always a place where there was going to be a victim. It was always a place where something was going to die, whether it was a pigeon or a bird or a cow or a lamb or whatever, or a human. It was where something was going to die. And he said that we're to present ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. I'm convinced that if we want more of what God wants for us, then we're going to have to be like this. It is no longer I that liveth, but it's Christ that liveth in me. We're going to have to be more like Paul. I'm forgetting those things that are past. I'm pressing towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. It's going to cost us something. So where do I start? Well, I like some advice that Paul gave Timothy in the 2 Timothy, the 1st chapter, the 5th verse out of the Amplified. Says, I'm calling up memories of your sincere and unqualified faith, the leaning of your entire personality on God and Christ, in absolute trust and confidence in his power. Now notice he said that we have to lean ourselves completely on him and have trust and confidence in his power. You know, God wants us to have confidence in his power, his wisdom and goodness, a faith that first lived permanently in the heart of your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am fully persuaded dwells in you also. So I believe it's going to take faith, don't you? Yes. He said, Paul, I see this faith. It was in your grandma. It was in your mom. And that same faith, I see it's in you. So really, if we're going to do that, we're going to have to be people of the word. Amen? I'm encouraging you today. This is for me. This is for the preacher just as much as anybody else. I'm encouraging you today. It's time to dive in. It's time to jump back in. It's time to put first things first. It's time to seek God first. It's time to get back in the Word like we've never been in the Word before. It's time to make it a habit in your life. I mean, where you're going to the Word every single day, you're going to the Word. You're going to the Word every single day. You're going to the Word. Why? It's going to take faith. And then he said this. That is why I would remind you to stir up, rekindle the embers, fan the flames of, and keep burning the gracious gift of God, the inner fire that is in you by means of the laying on of my hands with those of the elders at your ordination. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, of cowardice, of craven and cringing and fawning fear, but he has given us a spirit of power and of love and of a calm and well-balanced mind and discipline and self-control. Now here's, listen to this. Do not blush or be ashamed then to testify to and for our Lord, know of me a prisoner for his sake, but with me, this is what we need to hear, but with me, take your share of the suffering to which the preaching of the gospel may expose you to. Let me say it again. And take your share of the suffering to which the preaching of the gospel may expose you to, and do it in the power of God. It's going to be more and more the stuff you're going to have to put up with in the future Because you preach the word, you talk the word, you believe the word, you act on the word, you stand on the word. In the future, I'm telling you, it's going to take more and more of the fire of God on the inside of you. You know, I find this encouraging. Because all he's looking for, can you put that back up there? All he's looking for is just a little bit. You know where? Do you know which one it was? Huh? 2 Timothy, is it still froze? Yeah. 2 Timothy, the first chapter, begin at the fifth verse. Amplified. He said this, stir up, rekindle the embers of. So you could be in here today and there's an ember in there. I'm a pyromaniac. I get accused of that. I love fire. I do. I love to have fires. I love to have fires in the fireplace. I love to have fires outside. I used to love to burn leaves. I can't do it anymore in Waterloo. I just love fires. And if I'm going to have a fire, I love playing in the fire. I mean, if there's a fire, we're going to see if we can get that thing really stoking, really, really cooking, really, really blazing. And so lots of times you can have a fire and you can go out the next day and you can walk out and you can say, no fire. But yet you go and you get a little bit closer and you can take a little stick or you can blow a little bit and there's an ember. And you can take that ember, and because there's an ember, you can fan that flame. Listen, all God's looking for today, all he's looking for you today, is there just an ember on the inside of you? Because if there's just an ember, the fire is not out. Glory to God, the Holy Spirit can blow on you once again, afresh and anew. You can stir it up. Say, stir it up. Notice he said to Timothy, you stir it up. You stir it up. You stir it up. You know, there's one thing you have to learn is there's things that you have to do. A lot of us wanna go someplace and have somebody else stir us up. Amen. That's why. And there's nothing wrong with going and getting stirred. Amen. But there are times you're going to have to stir yourself up. There's not going to be anybody there to stir you up. Amen. You're going to have to take responsibility for your own flame. You're going to have to take responsibility whether you have little fire, no fire, or big fire. I want big fire. It's your responsibility. You have to stir yourself up. And there's a flame, there's an ember in there. So you have to stir yourself up. I don't feel like stirring myself up. That's when you need to stir yourself up. Amen. When you feel the least stirred, that's when you got to stir yourself up. When you feel the least bit of fire, that's when you need to stir yourself up. When you feel a million miles away from the things of God, that's when you got to stir yourself up. You know, you look at the life of David. There was times that David, he wished somebody would come and encourage him. I mean, read most of the Psalms. I mean, he's usually going through stuff, isn't he? But there was times he said, I just encouraged myself in the Lord. I laid on my bed and I just encouraged myself. What does that mean? Nobody was coming to do it for me. I'm going to encourage myself in the Lord. Glory to God. I think we just need to stand and encourage ourselves for a minute and stir it up before we go home. Oh, we stir up the flame in this place. Lord, we stir up the flame of God in this place. Lord, there's a sapahaha. Some of you need to take the poker. Some of you need to take the poker of your tongue. You need to take your tongue and stir around the embers that are on the inside of you. They're down there. There's an ember there. You need to stir it up. Stir it up. Stir it up. We sara sikaria stora basalara. Oh, riashile brema baranisha le bosa. Stir it up. Gloriosa, stirrosa, stir it up, stir it up, stir it up, fan the flame, fan the flame, fan the flame. Moshokota bastia la sakota bastiada. Hallelujah. Now we're going to encourage ourselves before I go home. Psalms 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul. and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Okay, let's bless him. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. I bless the Lord, O my soul, all that's within me. I bless your holy name. Now notice this, it gets better. He said, forget not his benefits. Hey, I don't care what you're going through. I don't care what it looked like on the other side. I don't care what your past has tried to dictate to you and still might be. There are benefits to serving God. Amen. He has provided a benefit package to you as a born-again child of God. What are the benefits? Who forgives all your iniquities? How many? All of them except. No. Every one of your sins, every one of your iniquities, he forgives in Jesus' name. You just ask him, he'll forgive it. He heals all your diseases. Oh, just thank him. Lord, I thank you that you heal all of my diseases. There's no disease known to man or even unknown that you don't heal. Every single disease, every single sickness, every single symptom in my body, you are the healer. He redeems your life from destruction. Oh my. I promise you, there's people in here. He redeemed your life from destruction. You didn't even know it was awaiting you. I promise you, there's been calamities, there's been traps, there's been situations that the enemy has placed before your life. You didn't even know it was there. And the Lord, he got your God, he redeemed you from that. Destructions, there's some of you, I mean, I'm convinced there's people who have sat in church. They've heard the word of God preached. They had things in their body. There was sickness and disease they didn't even know. But the Lord, out of his mercy, redeemed them and healed them. I'm convinced there's people in here that God set up things that when you were going down the road in your vehicle, you decided to go another way than you should have gone. That you took a different route and the Lord redeemed you from destruction out of an accident. It wouldn't surprise me one bit. Oh, thank you, Lord, for that benefit. Thank you, Lord, for redeeming us. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. Aren't you glad for the mercies of God? Oh, I'm telling you, if it was not for the mercy of God, there wouldn't be one of us in this place today. Not one of us. You can call on, he's so merciful. I like that they're tender. Tender mercies. Oh, Jesus, help us to be merciful. Help us to be tender. Who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like an eagle's. I'm telling you, the older I get, the more glad I am that there's a promise in the Word of God that I can stand on. Amen. Even when I'm trying to stand up and feel aches in my body I didn't ever experience 30 years ago. I'm so glad that he renews my youth like the eagles. And then one last psalm. This is really a good one. They're all good ones. This is a good one. Good one for this hour. I believe we're going to be living here. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High. How many dwellers? Huh? The secret place. You know, that's really what I'm talking about, is dwelling in that secret place, being on fire, being full of God, being full of the Word, being on fire, being close in. I mean, to be under the shadow of something, you got to be close in. Right? Not drifting out here far off somewhere. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say, now notice you got to say something. I said you got to say this. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, and him will I trust. So let's just tell him that, Lord, you're my God, you're my fortress. It's in you whom I trust. Now just say this. Surely he shall deliver me. from the snare of the fowler, and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover me with his feathers, and under his wings I shall take refuge. His truth shall be my shield and buckler. I shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. Now say this: 1,000 may fall at my side, 10,000 at my right hand, but it shall not come near me. Only with my eyes shall I look and see the reward of the wicked. Now listen to this. Because I have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, my dwelling place. No evil shall befall me, nor shall any plague come near my dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over me, to keep me in all my ways. In their hands they bear me up, lest I dash my foot against a stone. Here's one the devil doesn't like to hear. I shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent. I shall trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon me, there shall he shall deliver me. He has set him on high because he's known my name. I shall call upon him and he will answer me. He will be with me in trouble. He will deliver me and honor me with long life. He will satisfy me and show me his salvation. That's for you. Thank God for the word. Father, as we leave today, I thank you so much for your word. And Lord, we just dedicate afresh and anew our hearts to you. Lord, that we are going to lay aside the weights, the sins, the things that so easily beset us, that we can run the race with patience that's set before us. Father, that you will show us those things in our life, the hindrances, the areas, the places that need to be moved around, need to be shuffled, need to be reprioritized. I thank you for doing it. In the name of Jesus, amen.
He's the one who's given me his promises. He's the one that has to bring it to pass.